right. Well, I'm very excited to be here with Angelo and Norwood of Fishbone. Guys, thank you so much for being with us here at Slow Brew.
Oh, yeah, man. You're welcome.
I appreciate you having us. Really, you know, we play Slow Brew a long time, and this new facility is amazing.
It's all new, right? It's totally different, and we're up above Slow Brew, kind of in the green room, and there's sort of some suites up here. So a little change of pace from what you guys were used to last time you were coming to town.
Yeah, but it was always hospitable, always a good time, always a good audience.
Very cool, man. Very cool. Well, you guys strike me as a band that's really grateful. I mean, even the gratitude I'm sensing from you, just really grateful for the fans, grateful to still be out doing what you're doing. And a couple weeks ago, I had the pleasure of going to a concert where I did an interview with Pauline Black and Gaps from The Selector. And we were right in the front row in L.A., and who should jump on stage during the opening band, the Delirians?
I did that, and I was singing with the Delirians.
Yeah.
Me and one of the guys from Hepcat and Cheshire Bathwaite were singing.
That's right.
Yeah, and so we did a Jamaican ska cover.
Yeah. What was the track? It was My Mama Don't...
Scandal...
In the Family.
In the Family. Yes, Scandal in the Family.
There we go. A classic staple back in Jamaica, I guess. Yeah.
So we learned that one real quick, and we got up there and we sang it out, man. So it was good.
Oh, man, that was great.
It was a real pleasure to open up for The Selector, man. That's like one of my heroes, man. Like before I started singing like Angelo, I was singing like Pauline Black.
Well, so many people, you know, that was an interesting night. Who else was there, man? We had Tony from No Doubt, who I know you guys through the years kind of connected with them. You guys were a huge influence on them.
Yeah, so Tony was there too.
Yeah,
he was there checking it out. It was a lot of people there, man, to see The Selector.
Yeah.
A lot of people I haven't seen in a lot. It's like a high school reunion,
really?
Seeing them play, you know.
Well, I'm glad I was there, man. That's a very special night, and I'm glad I was in the audience to check that out.
Good show too.
Very cool, very cool. Well, guys, I know you guys both in other interviews have talked about your various influences, and you know, I don't want to go into too much of that, but one of the things that really surprised me is I always was under the false impression that you guys, being of the era that you were, kind of in the later 70s, LA punk, ska, all the, it's hard to categorize you guys, but I always sort of envisioned you guys as having been, to some extent, influenced by the two-tone stuff. But in one of the, initially, in your formation, but in one of the interviews you guys did, you talked about how you were sort of already doing your thing when you heard about, like, what was going on across the Atlantic.
It was a brief moment where, you know, like, one day we sped up some reggae to punk rock tempos, and I thought we invented something. It was less than 3 days. It was probably like 2 days, and Walt came in with a Selector cassette and an English Beat cassette and was like, oh, this thing already exists.
What was that like for you emotionally? I mean, reassuring on some level to know that you were part of a bigger thing, but also kind of a bummer that you thought maybe you started a certain sound?
Well, I mean, you know, like, that's exactly somewhat, but it was actually like what those bands were doing was so cool.
Yeah.
Like, it was like, okay, now just let me discover what this is, you know, like, really, and... The fact is that, like, it took us to the movie Dance Craze to really, like, light us up. And then through the Dance Craze kind of solidified, like, oh, man, there's, you know, and the Specials were kings, right?
Yeah.
And, you know, all the other bands were amazing. And and then locally, there was plenty of bands, the Skanksters and, you know, the Untouchables. Yeah. You know, we were young, 14, and some of these bands started around the same time. I'm sure some of them predated us.
Yeah.
And, you know, to discover the local ska bands and reggae bands, and then discover that the music goes back to Jamaica.
Yeah.
That was kind of the whole journey, you know?
Yeah.
So it made it fun.
I mean, in other interviews, Angelo, too, I mean, again, the gratitude that you guys both exhibit. I remember you guys talking about playing with a proto-punk band, Death, and just how epic that was. And African-American rockers and punkers, I mean, just trailblazing beyond belief. So you guys always tip the hat, or the fez, as it were, to your influences. For you, Angelo, of that era, you know, when you saw Dance Craze and were like, damn, Body Snatchers, you know, Madness, all these folks. Which of those artists resonated with you? I mean, was it like the Specials where you really had the mix of...
I was really fascinated by the Specials, man, because they were the most chaotic of all the bands that I would see, you know. But then the Selector was... I was really digging Pauline Black singing, you know. Definitely. And then there was Bad Manners, too.
Yeah.
You know,
it's rowdy.
As far as like the ska scene, and that movie Dance Craze.
Yeah.
You know, and then there was... Decline of the Western Civilization was going at the same time, and then Rocky Horror Picture Show, like I was seeing earlier, was like happening at the same time. So I would just be seeing all of those movies. They'd be like late night, and I'd go see Rocky Horror Picture Show, and in the theater next to it or down the street would be playing Dance Craze.
It's a beautiful mix.
So I would catch all of that stuff around that same time.
See how that all just absorbed in the young mind of Angelo and kind of influenced you, man. I mean, the L.A. punk scene, you know, you guys definitely being from L.A. and being kind of influenced by some of that stuff that was coming up, you know, Black Flag, you know, even the D.C. stuff, of course, Bad Brains and all that. I mean, that really want to ask you guys about what the scene was like in L.A., especially for you guys, and whether that was is a band that was coming up in particularly an African-American band, you know, whether that scene was, whether it was really accommodating, you know, like the two-tone scene in Britain, or whether there were issues, barriers that...
Man, I mean, there was a lot of racism going on back at that time from what I remember, because I grew up in the Valley, which was predominantly white, and my family was one of the first black families moving out there. And so I would experience a lot of that stuff riding the bus home from L.A. from rehearsal, Fishbone rehearsal, actually. And coming back to San Fernando Valley.
Wow.
And I would experience some of that stuff, you know. But but the crowds that would come to our show were predominantly white, because we were playing a lot of punk rock and rock, too, you know, along with our funk and our soul that we were doing. But it was just, from what I remember, our audiences were majority white for a long time because of the music that we were playing and the intensity that we played in that. Even though it's all soul and funk based, because our roots are like James Brown and Funkadelic and Sly Stone and all that.
There's been a lot of talk about, you know, the L.A. punk scene and through the years and how sort of like accommodating or inclusive it was, or how uninclusive it was. What was your experience?
I always, in the music scene overall, like, I don't recall really having much for problems, you know, like when it comes down to it, we played our first club date in 1983. And by 1985, we were on a major label with a release on like the biggest label on the planet at the time, right? So, you know, we actually, it seemed like it was a hard and fought struggle, but in hindsight, it was like, ooh, that was kind of quick.
Yeah, you guys ascended pretty quickly.
Yeah, so, you know, like we just hit it hard, and you know, there was not much. There was times when you kind of felt maybe from a band, like, you know, some there was times when, but it wouldn't matter what color, you know, our skin was. They would just be assholes to anybody they didn't know.
Yeah.
So I can't say that there was, in the music scene, there was that. There was, now, L.A. had, you know, some, the surrounding areas, there was some punk rock gangs that had, like, skinhead, racist, Nazi tendencies. So, you know, like, we didn't ever get into no real gang fights with them. They never stepped to us like that. We were the scrap, you know, because we... You know, for
the Olympic Auditorium with the Dead Kennedys.
I mean,
oh, you guys had an incident with DK?
Yeah, I got stabbed, but
really?
Oh, wow. Yeah, but I again, like, you know what? I don't know that was because I'm black. You know what I mean? It was just something that happened, you know?
Yeah.
So and that's not me, you know, I just can't say that guy was racist. I don't know. He didn't say nothing. He spit at the band. Yeah. I jumped out to kick his ass.
He was an equal opportunity asshole, perhaps, or
maybe,
you don't know.
I don't know what why he did what he did. He was, you know, So whatever. Like, bottom line is, like, there were people here and there that you'd be like, oh, that's kind of that mug. It must be racist. But overall, the scene was accommodating.
Yeah. Okay.
You know, like, we played with every kind of band. There was some racist stuff that I heard, because we used to roll with. There was this Latino band called Wild Card, the Wild Cards. And they were bad as fuck, man. And they did rockabilly mixed with like soul, and
East LA old school, like
yeah. But it was like, it was a mixture. They were slick. Sometimes they go into these slow jams. It was good as any Marvin Gaye song, but they would like rip it with this jump jazz and rockabilly.
Yeah.
So we did quite a few shows with them, and I was standing at the back of a room. I think it was Madame Wong's Chinatown.
I was going to ask you guys about Madame Wong's. That's a name that comes up so much when we talk to bands of that era, punk bands.
Yeah, I mean, they were nurturing, absolutely, of what we were doing, you know. So, and I was standing at the back of the room enjoying the Wild Cards. Mm-hmm. And this dude was talking to me. He was a rockabilly kid, and I was like, man, this band is incredible. He's like, yeah, they're really good, but who wants to see a bunch of beaners? Mm-hmm. Like, you know what I mean? So that happened. So, you know what I mean? Like, I can say he said something that was like, oh, really? And you like my band and you think I think that's cool?
He
no.
He assumes you're cool with it. Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not cool with that.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So.
Well, it's very similar. We interviewed Dave Dichter of MDC recently, and he came out with a book. And, you know, he talked a little bit about the HR stuff that back in the day he had some issues with and kind of went on record and, you know, kind of. And it's interesting because sometimes you hear things, and when people are telling it to you, they're saying it openly because they assume you're down with it.
Yeah.
And that's a big assumption, right?
Like, yeah. That happened, yeah. But you know what? That guy didn't systematically stop Wild Card from getting a show. Yeah. He didn't systematically stop anybody from doing anything. You know, like later on, I became involved in the East LA music scene, nurturing bands. And it was because a friend of mine who was named Eddie Ayala, who was in the East LA punk rock band Los Illegals, he called me and asked me for help bringing younger East LA bands in the clubs. He said because the clubs didn't want to book the bands.
I was going to ask you about that. Even in general, I've heard stories about it being really hard in that era. We even interviewed the Damned, and they were talking about how they had a hard time getting it playing at the Roxy, late 70s, early 80s. It was tough for even white punk rock bands sometimes, but especially ethnic minority groups, perhaps. It sounds like there was even more resistance or whatever.
We were preceded by, on the LA scene, we were preceded by the Busboys, who by the time we came along, they had grown to be what we thought were, they were gigantic.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So they maneuvered through it. You know, different bands were able to maneuver through, and maybe there was resistance, but I can't blame it on race. It's like our first club gig was at Madame Wong's Chinatown, you know? And it took us a while to begin to be able to play club lingerie. But you had to build up and become, be able to bring people into that room, And there was the Hollywood hipster scene, which, eventually we were embraced by that. But it took, you had to play and be seen by the right people and be embraced by it, And any band, there was tons of bands that didn't. So once we did a show that put us in front of those people, we became the darlings of that thing.
You were catapulted, whether you wanted to or not.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So, again, the music industry has obstacles for sure. And some of that is based on race. And we came up in a time where the music industry absolutely had boundaries based on race. Mm-hmm. But the club scene, I'm saying, I didn't see the club scene so much. Later on, when my friend Eddie came to me, this was in the 90s, there was Latino bands having a hard time getting in the clubs. Gotcha. Hollywood clubs did not want to book them. And, you know, like, so, yes, it happened. Our experience was we kicked down all the doors. If it was an obstacle, I might have been blind to it because we was kicking so hard.
That's beautiful, man. I'm sorry to hear you guys struggled, but you persevered, and the resilience of you guys is amazing.
We were young when we started off, and we had no clue on how to go. I didn't know that I could go to a club and see a band, you know. And maybe the first punk rock band I went to go see was, you know, because I went to the Who's first farewell tour at the Coliseum, and the Clash opened, right?
Yeah.
And then maybe a year after that, there was a party in my grandmother's. This is a black neighborhood. You know, and it was a party in a garage on my grandmother's block, and the drummer was Hunt Sales from Tin Machine, if you don't know, right? And Hunt Sales, me and my brother went, because we thought it was hilarious because he was Soupy Sales' son, right?
Okay,
but he was playing with this punk rock band, and the flyer, it said Don't Know, or it was either Don't Know or Doctor No. I still, to this day, don't remember which band it was. And when I finally met Hunt Sales, I asked him about it, and he doesn't remember playing with the band at all. But that was what was on the flyer. And, you know, so I didn't know I could go sneak into clubs and whatnot. Kendall Jones had a cousin named Ira that was a bouncer at the Vex. And so Ira would take Kendall to the Vex every now and again. Kendall saw Black Flag at the Vex. I remember Kendall coming back from those shows, but Kendall was scared of punk rock.
Yeah, he saw the rawness of it, right?
Yeah, he was a little scared of it.
Yeah,
you know, but that's what, he was more like. But that, you know, Kendall loved power pop.
You know? I like it too, man. Paul Collins, that was a big thing. Yeah. The Beat,
like The Question, and. Yeah. Chardon Square, and you know, like the 3 o'clock.
Oh, yeah, you know. And the whole 3 o'clock, the Paisley Underground scene in L.A.
All of that.
So like, you guys' interests. I mean, I bet there's almost nothing you guys don't like. I mean, you're so your expertise knows no bounds.
Like nosebleed techno.
No, okay, so no EDM.
Nosebleed techno.
All right.
Oh yeah, I can't stand that shit.
So we got one little.
we were exploratory, and that's what you get with our music. It's just we thought we were free.
When I think of a band that defies
not knowing no boundaries, not knowing or caring about any boundaries, and looking at it all as music,
exactly,
right? You get all these different styles of music, you know, and they're all there for you to play and enjoy. So why not do it?
And you guys are so good at all of those styles. I mean, whether it's the punk, almost a metal-ish kind of vibe on some of your stuff. Of course, you know, the ska influence. I mean, you guys are sort of the jack of all trades, masters of all trades, really. I mean, you guys are amazing. Angelo, we brought up some big names here when we're talking about influences and collaborations. Over the years, you've collaborated with lots of folks. I just want to ask you, you know, maybe off the top of your head, what some of the top collabos were in terms of touring, jumping on stage, and maybe you know.
Man, that's like a needle in a haystack.
It's a tough one, man. Just kind of, and no offense to anybody that Angelo doesn't mention, because he's not dissing you. It's just hard to remember the wide range.
I can tell you what I've been doing lately. I've been doing this Prince tribute with Carl Denson in the Tiny Universe.
All right, nice.
So I've been singing the whole Dirty Mind album.
Ooh, wow. All
right. Right, and I did a couple of shows for a celebration of David Bowie.
Okay.
Yeah, I did a couple of his songs, you know, so there's a lot of people playing with him. Who else, man? Shaka Punk, it's another one from France. I guess I consider them power pop. I don't know.
Yeah. But you're just really putting yourself out there, even with the contemporary bands, just to really connect.
I mean, it's just so many people, man.
Yeah.
once they start coming into my head, they'll be flowing in, okay. And you won't be able to
maybe
stop
I'll
me.
Yeah. Norwood, and then don't interrupt. And yeah. How about you, Norwood, in terms of collabos or just memories of taking gracing the stage with other artists over the years?
Yeah, you know what? One of my favorite things that we ever did was a band from Argentina called Los Fabulosos Cadillacs. Mm. And Los Fabulosos Cadillacs reached out to us to do a full band, two bands at once, collaboration, really? On doing Tom Jones' version of What's New Pussycat.
Wow. And just the whole premise of that is screams unique from the beginning.
For it too.
Really? All right. We'll link to that for sure.
Yes. It was amazing. It was amazing. And actually, you know, they're from Argentina, and at the time they were the biggest band on the planet, like selling more records than anybody, you know. But the American public, if you didn't speak Spanish, it went by you, right?
Yeah.
And they brought us in, and they opened up Argentina to us.
Oh, wow.
You know, so that was...
new market for Fishbone to get fans. You know?
Oh, yeah, absolutely. So that was absolutely one of my favorite things that we've done. I've been fortunate enough to step on stage with like George Clinton quite a bit, and you know, do some studio work with George Clinton and have him come and, you know, we'd made a whole album of people coming in and sharing verses and stuff, like, you know, Gwen Stefani and Perry Farrell and
you guys used to kick it with part of that, going to his parties.
People on horns played on Jane's Addiction albums and we collaborated with Chili Peppers many times in many different ways.
You were a huge influence.
Collaborating with Tokyo Ska Paradise Orchestra is another one from Japan.
You mentioned them in some other interviews. You're a huge fan of them, right?
Yeah, I like those guys, you know, and I did a song with them for the tsunami relief. Yeah, so that was a good experience, too.
Not only wonderful musicians, but your heart for humanity, charity work, you know, putting yourself out there, you know, internationally. It's a beautiful thing.
The Los Fabulosos Cadillacs collaboration was for a Red Hot Latin AIDS fundraising album.
Part of the whole Red Hot and Blue kind of tradition of all that,
Yeah, so that was a part of that. And there's been other things, too, that we've done over the years, like, you know, like bring...
Brass band.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Dumps to Funk.
Yeah. Herb Albert, Sergio Mendes.
I don't know. We played with Femi Cootie, but I don't ever think we were on a stage with them, though.
Real World Label. Yeah, great stuff.
Yeah, yes. It's a lot of stuff. It's hard to remember all of it, but it's definitely... You know, that's actually one of the biggest compliments is to when, you know, artists share the creative space or actually, you know, to go and do, you know, even just say, hey, let's jam and do some covers or whatever, you know. So, you know, I've been fortunate enough in the last few years to just, you know, be able to go, like, do a bunch of stuff throughout New Orleans and Chicago and, you know, jam with the guys Eric Krasno from Soul Live you know, some of the guys from Lettuce and you know, it could go on and on. It's a lot of stuff that's happened.
Well, in terms of collaborations that you would like to do or that you wish that you had the opportunity to do through the years, are there any names on that list?
You know what? Tina Turner. I think Fishbone and Tina Turner would be the most epic combination, because she's punk as fuck when it comes down to it. You know, that to me, like, that would be the most epic, you know, collaborate, because it actually makes sense.
It does,
in my head.
Yeah,
you know, that, like, okay, like, you know, she was married to Ike Turner, and whatever asshole he was on this planet,
he used to come in our studio, or at least on the other side of it in LA. Yeah.
Yo, leave his cards and his flyers, and he wanted to work with us. Ike actually gave us Distortion, right? He's the guy. If it was not for Ike Turner, whatever asshole he was in his life, his amp had to fall off the back of his station wagon and rip a speaker so that we could have Metallica and Slayer.
Oh, wow. I didn't know that. So the origin of the distortion pedal, or just a distorted amp?
Distorted guitar. His speaker ripped, yeah. And he went, oh, that's kind of cool. I think I'm going to go with it.
Wow, okay.
And from there, we have Meshuggah.
Yep, distorted guitar. All for Mike Turner, ain't that something?
Big ups for that.
Tina Turner, like you know what I mean? Like, and Tina Turner, actually, dude, if that's one of those like
dreams,
you know?
Like, yeah.
And then the one that really like got away that would have been like the passed away. Would have been Fela Kuti, okay. Or Sun Ra,
yeah,
right?
Sun Ra, yeah.
Like that as a.
Screaming Jay Hawkins was somebody I've always wanted to make music with.
Yes, indeed.
I used to talk to Screaming Jay Hawkins on the phone.
Really.
Mm. You know.
In what context? I mean, if I may ask.
Well, we just used to shoot the shit, man, but. You know, he was kind of out there, and he was another one of the dudes that might say some things that you go like, I'm not really with that. You know, because
serious stuff.
But he was a war veteran, like a Korean War or something like that, and he had some things associated with that war you know what I mean.
The negative intolerance of certain ethnic groups, maybe exactly. Something like that.
But you know what. Like sometimes you look at a generation ago and you go like, you know what, they were raised in a different way. And like, so today, like, you know, I got a 15-year-old daughter and we had these conversations about when she was in elementary school, there was things that people used to say, her peer group, that today is not okay.
Gotcha.
And her peer group, there's some people like, you know, I'm going to hate to bring up this thing, but it's part of the conversation. It's like in the wake of Donald Trump, you know, there's some people that like her schoolmates that are emboldened to say some insane things, you know, but the general feel from the generation is, there's a lot of things that like are not okay, and if we keep on this path, we absolutely maybe are looking forward to a better world.
Yeah.
You know?
I feel you. And it happens, it's not too, I mean, not even that many years ago, LGBTQ advocates were saying there's no way that gay marriage is going to be recognized.
Yeah,
and you nudge it, or marijuana legalization. I mean, a different sort of thing, but different civil rights.
That make me say, like, you know what, things are getting better. It's not perfect. It might not even be all the way good. But because LGBTQ things have moved to where they have moved, because pot legalization, because Black Lives Matter, because of all of these things, you know, I'm like, you know what? People are taking a stand.
Well, man, so many things, and I know you're busy and I want to wrap things up here, but Angelo, giving you a chance to follow up on what he was saying about collaborations, ones that maybe you haven't had the chance to do or that you would like to do in the future. Do you have any names on your list, aside from Tina? Because he already chose Tina, so.
Okay, we were Screaming Jay Hawkins. I would have liked to have worked with Shirley Bassey, Goldfinger. Edith Piaf is somebody else I'd like to have sang with.
Interesting, man.
I can tell you some people I have collaborated with.
All right. Well,
George Lynch from the Lynch Mob.
Oh, okay.
And we released a CD called Project Infidelica, which is pretty good, man. And I never thought I'd work with anybody from Dokken.
That's an interesting collabo for sure. How did that happen?
It turned out pretty good, man. It's a pretty rocking CD. Pretty good, man. Yeah, and I got like an electronic dance music enhanced CD that I have out called A Brand New Step.
I know you mentioned
EDM earlier.
Yeah, so that's another genre you've stepped into.
Crossover into right, and expand my boundaries, my musical boundaries.
Right. Man, I mean, you guys, seriously, and we do a lot of interviews with a lot of bands.
Ray Charles, I would have liked to work with Ray Charles.
Ray, yeah.
Louis Jordan. I like Louis Jordan.
Yeah, yeah.
Wynonie Harris.
Oh, okay.
I like a lot of old jazz, swing jazz and stuff.
As I was going to say, I mean, your interests know no
Shirley
bounds.
Shirley Caesar.
I know.
Oh, my God, Shirley Caesar.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, that's gospel.
Yeah. What? Oh, okay. Yeah, no, I mean, it's just beautiful, man. And you guys, both of you, your interests just go on and on. And I think that's one reason I respect you. One of many reasons I respect you guys.
Clara Rockmore. Right. Yeah, the thereminist.
Okay.
Clara Rockmore.
For those that don't know, you know, we do see the theremin on stage often. It is a staple of Fishbone shows, and you're quite the master of that instrument.
Well, thank you, man. I've been practicing a lot lately.
Okay. When I was 10, one of the coolest double features that I went to was seeing Footloose with Breakin' 2 Electric Boogaloo. Uh-huh. And I've had the pleasure of actually interviewing Michael Chambers, a.k.a. Turbo, and got to hang out with him. I actually got to break, kick it and actually pop and lock with him, which was my 10-year-old self could not believe that I was kicking it in the VIP breakdancing with Michael Chambers. You had a little cameo.
Right? Yeah. It was a Breakin' 2. I had a flat top with some round glasses.
Were you in the circle when everybody was getting down?
On a street corner or something like that, man.
Okay.
Yeah, yeah.
Were you part of that scene back in the day? We didn't talk about hip-hop too much or breakdancing, but you just were like an extra?
I was in the pop-locking scene pretty big, man. I used to pop-lock in Westwood and Hollywood Boulevard and at Venice Beach and stuff like that.
Okay.
Had a group called Royal Plexo Flex.
All right.
Yeah.
So you guys used to battle and stuff?
Yeah.
Yeah?
Right. Yeah, used to battle different groups.
And I didn't know that. I just asked this question innocently. No, but
then I ended up choosing more the music than that dance form, man, because even though that dance form is fun as hell, yeah. You know, I thought to myself it's more gratifying to make the thing that makes people dance rather than just dancing to it. You want to be able to make the thing, which is music, to make people dance to.
Interesting. That's deep, man.
Then you become the puppet master.
You control the means of production, right? Yeah,
very good, very good.
Yeah. All right, guys. Well, I can't think of a better place to end it, but I want to thank both of you for your time. It's been a deep, deep honor for me, and I want to thank both of you, man. Thank you so much. Thanks, Angelo.